Very good morning to one and all the students of class Prasan B. So most of the students have joined now. So let's start and continue with the chapter Ailing Planet, Green Movement's Role, written by Nani Palkhiwala. So I already told you that this chapter is actually an article which was published fine in the newspaper, and that article became so famous that now it is there in your syllabus of class plus one. Fine. This article was published in the newspaper, the Indian Express, on the date 23rd November 1994. Okay. So this was basically an article published in the Indian Express. And then now it is the chapter of your class plus one NCERT syllabus. Okay. Before continuing with the chapter, I would like to share the screen and let's see if you are able to watch it. Yes, tell me, are you able to see what's on my screen? Yes, Mitali, tell me what you can see on the screen. Mitali Thakur, tell me what you can see on the screen. Yes, children, do you see the screen? Yesterday I was unable to share, but I tried another method now today. So I'm asking any one of you. Manjot, what do you see on the screen? Is there any picture which you can see? Yes. Just send me the feedback. Let me check first those who are there again. Ramanjeet is saying yes, Khyati Vaibhav. So you are able to see the picture I shared. Okay, Ramanjeet, tell me, speak please. And tell me, what do you see on the screen earlier? I stopped sharing it. Now you tell me. What did you see on the screen?
Ma'am, a picture with showing earth in the hand.
Okay, fine. You can mute yourself. I just wanted to confirm because yesterday also I was not able to share. So students are still joining. Now I'll share again. So it's visible to you. Fine. So let me discuss those who were absent yesterday. Let's share. See, now you can see a picture of Earth in hands. What does it suggest? This is very suggestive picture, which is giving us an idea that our planet Earth, fine, Anjali will tell us. Yes, Anjali, kindly speak. What does this picture suggest?
Ma'am, this picture suggests that we should always save our earth. We should not harm our earth.
And the responsibility is in our own hands. Fine. So we can save the earth. We can save the earth. We are the ones who are ruining it actually. Fine. And we are the ones who are spoiling it, and responsibility lies totally in our hands, how we are going to handle and save the Mother Earth. So this chapter, Ailing Planet, ailing means the health is deteriorating. This planet, this chapter suggests us that, that our Earth is becoming, you can say, ill day by day, and responsibility lies in our hands. So Nani Palkhiwala has, you know, he has mentioned that, yes, our earth is ailing, but responsibility lies in our hands. We should save the environment. And who else can save it? People all together. And green movement was, I already told you that it started in 1972 in New Zealand. And the main purpose of the green movement was to create awareness towards the environment. Earlier, there was just materialistic view of the people towards the things. But now slowly and steadily, when green movement started, nobody thought in their lives that it will become so huge, that green movement initiated in each and every country of the world, and every country of the world participated, and they started having awareness. They started having NGOs, they started having organizations, those who started working for because betterment of the environment. And now from materialistic view to ecological view, people are moving. You can see in the picture also. Now, let me ask. Yes, Khyati, what do you see in this picture?
Ma'am, in this picture, people are supporting the green, people are supporting the green movement, and they are,
what is the caption?
Basically, protesting against those who are polluting the earth and causing harm to it.
Yes. Very good. So it is clearly seen in the picture that how people are becoming aware nowadays. Fine. Listen to the people, not polluters. So there are two categories of people. Fine. And those who are polluting the earth and those who are creating awareness, and they themselves are aware also, and they want others to get aware. So earlier it was not so. It has become a mass movement now. That green movement started at a very small scale in New Zealand. Then it took very large scale later on in many countries. People started getting aware. Even in your country, we have many organizations working for the betterment of our environment. Fine. So Greenpeace is the new concept these days, that let's spread peace. Greenpeace means let's be aware. It doesn't mean that you need to grow plants only if you cannot grow. Yes, you should grow plants at least once, twice in your lifetime or more than that. But if it is not possible for you to grow plants, at least let's not pollute it. Let's save our earth. Let's contribute in the miniature acts by switching off the lights, by turning off the taps, by not littering the places where we live, by not littering the places where we travel. Okay, so these are the little things which we can do. Okay, so I just, now you can see in the picture the ailing planet, the green movement role. So this is the chapter which we are reading. You can see in the picture the earth is crying. So this is, you can say, very pictorial presentation that how we are making our earth crying. Fine. And why it is crying? Because health is deteriorating. When we are not in good health, obviously our mood will get affected. Similarly, Mother Earth should be considered as living organism. When you see this picture, this is just a symbol of, you can say, we should consider Earth as one big unit of living organism. The way we people are living and breathing, we should consider also one living organism. The way we need treatment when we are ill, Earth also needs treatment when it is ill. Fine. So we should be responsible citizens, and we should save our environment by becoming responsible. So responsibility lies in our hands. Okay. Now, wait. Now, please note down the points from the board. I have written some points, so I'll be speaking also in case it's not visible. First and foremost point is deteriorating health of the earth. So I have written some points what Nani Palkhiwala has mentioned in this article. Firstly, he will be discussing deteriorating health of the earth, that how the health of the earth is deteriorating day by day. It is not good. Fine. And then green movement's role in improving the health of the earth. I already discussed that green movement was the movement initiated in New Zealand in 1972. And the main purpose of this movement was to create awareness among the masses from materialistic view to ecological view. You know, one should think about environment. Fine. That is the ecological view. So green movement's role was to create awareness among the masses. Fine, man, the most dangerous animal of this earth. So I would like to share one incident with you in this chapter. You know, author, writer, Nani Palkhivala has mentioned that there is, you know, one zoo at Lusaka, Zambia. The name of the place is that. Fine. So we will be reading in the chapter when I will share the screen with you. So there is one zoo in Lusaka, Zambia, and there is one cage. You know, obviously, what do we do in the zoo? We go to watch animals, fine. Some animals, obviously, when they are dangerous, they are put in the cages only. So there is one cage, and when we go there and when we look into the cage, there is one big mirror. Fine. And the caption over the mirror says the world's most dangerous animal. So you can very well imagine, what does it mean? What does it mean? Anyone? Ishnur, please tell me. There is one zoo in which a mirror is placed, and when you look yourself, when you just have a look of that cage, what does it mean, Ishnur? Yes, you unmuted yourself, and then yes, Ishnur beta, you can speak beta.
Mom, that we should look upon ourselves also, that when we are kept in a cage, how the animals would feel.
No, you are mistaken here. You could not understand the true meaning. Anybody else would like to try? See, I'll just repeat. There is one mirror, fine, in the cage, and the caption over the cage is the world's most dangerous animal. Very easy it is, very easy. Give it a try. Just raise your hand. Raghav. Very good. Yes, beta.
Ma'am, that we, the humans, are the most dangerous animals, that we are keeping the animals in the zoo or harming the environment.
Very good. So exactly this is correct. So well done, Raghav, for recognizing the idea behind this. So Lusaka, Zambia, that zoo, when there is cage and mirror and the caption says the world's most dangerous animal, actually they want to give a message to the society that man is the most dangerous animal in this world. Because, you know, animals can be trained to do something in lives. We people, we are being educated even. We are not even taking care of, you know, when a dog sits at a place, you might see that when a dog sits at a place, firstly, he will clean the place with his tail, fine? And then he will sit over there. In cats, they are like very, you know, cleanliness lovers. So they keep on cleaning their bodies. They keep on licking their bodies because this is the only way they clean themselves. So I'm just giving example that even dogs and cats and other animals, they know the importance of cleanliness. They know the importance of, you know, that places they are living and how to make it clean. And we people are harming the environment. We know that if we will kill animals, if we'll kill birds, if we will ruin the environment, we will cut trees. This is actually, that's why we are being masked up these days. Most of viruses are there, and you can say air quality is very poor, and just because of us. So we need to be aware. So this is the chapter where we are getting awareness. So next point is, according to the writer, there is change in perception, but writer has not only discussed the bad points of this ailing planet. He is saying that yes, definitely there are a lot of problems, but there is change of perception also. Now people are becoming more and more aware. They are being educated and they are taking part in many movements, and they themselves are doing many efforts. Fine. So I told you in the class also, we discussed that there is one boy, one video was there. So he says that he's just a teenager, and he has started that, you know, out of his compassion, that he used to visit the coastal areas over there. People go to visit beaches and all, and there is a lot of garbage lying over there. He felt very bad. He started collecting in his polythene, and then many of his friends joined, and now he started, now after so many years, he is one of the famous business tycoons in Maharashtra over there, and he has started his, you know, private business of collecting the garbages and using that, you know, reduce, recycle, reuse, that concept he has initiated. So out of that basic habit, he has started a business now. So I'm just giving you one example that how people are becoming aware. That was his habit. Nobody asked him to do so. He was like self-aware only about this. So then from materialistic to ecological view. So writer is saying that people are earlier, they were quite materialistic, but now they are becoming having ecological view and holistic view that this is our responsibility to save the environment. And then last but not the least is we should do something to save the environment. So it is in our hands. We should do small efforts at least to save the environment. So I'm now going to share the screen of the chapter. Let's continue. Fine. We have read so far, fine, till future generations. Now I'll be continuing from the concept of sustainable development. The concept of sustainable development, is it visible, Vita? The screen is visible to you all? Send me the feedback if you can see the screen. Okay, fine, thank you. Let's continue. Now, I'll be discussing the concept of sustainable development. The concept of sustainable development was popularized in 1987 by the World Commission on Environment and Development. Underline this, Peter. In its report, it defined the idea as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. That is, without stripping the natural world of resources future generations would need. So already we discussed yesterday in detail what is sustainable development. Use the resources wisely and think that you have borrowed it from the posterity. You have borrowed it from the coming generation. You are not the only owner of these things. So use it wisely in a moderate amount so that coming generations will be able to use it also and teach them also to be responsible citizens. Okay. Then in the example I was giving you, Nani Palkhiwala has mentioned in his article, in the zoo at Lusaka, Zambia, there is a cage where the notice reads, the world's most dangerous animal. And inside the cage, there is no animal, but a mirror where you see yourself. Thanks to the efforts of a number of agencies in different countries, a new awareness has now dawned upon the most dangerous animal in the world. He has realized the wisdom of shifting from a system based on domination to one based on partnership. So he's saying that this, you know, example from Lusaka, Zambia is also one of the example of awareness that yes, the owners of the zoo or the people who are into this, they became quite responsible towards it, that world's most dangerous animal is man only, fine. So see yourself. This is the message they want to give. Thanks to the efforts. So they are thanking, Nani Palkhiwala is thanking to the efforts made by a number of agencies, many NGOs, many people who are into this realization that Earth is our own house and we need to take care of it. So he has realized this, that people have, you know, becoming realistic too. They have now understood that this is the collaborative effort only which can save them from this. Scientists have cataloged. Now, Beta, you need to underline this. The data will be given to you. Now, its data might be changed because this book was written many years ago. So there might be some changes also, but we have to stick to the data given in the book only. Scientists have cataloged about 1.4 million living species with which mankind shares the earth. Estimates vary. Vary means change. Vary widely as regards the still uncataloged living species. Biologists reckon that about 3 to 100 million other living species still languish unnamed in ignominious darkness. So now the writer is saying in this that you might have seen Discovery Channel. On that Discovery Channel, they show many species living. Even sometimes we have not eyewitnessed such kind of birds and animals in our lives, which we see on Discovery Channel and such sort of other channels also. So scientists, they have, you know, cataloged that 1.4 million living species. There are other species also, you know, you have read life cycle and like how one creature eats the other and how that cycle completes. So dearth of one species will lead to definitely affect the other species also. So he's saying that 1.4 million living species are there And even these are the recorded ones, cataloged ones, but there it data will definitely vary. It will change because there are some categories which are still uncataloged, which is not cataloged by any of the scientists. And biologists reckon that like 300 to 100 million other living species are still there, which are not being recorded. Clear? Fine. Cataloged here means classified, right? And reckon, that word means calculate. Clear? Reckon means calculate. I already, gave you the word meanings yesterday. We discussed languish means lack of vitality of a person. Languish means lack of vitality of a person or plant or animal. Right? Means when it is growing very weak, that is languish. Clear? Ignominious darkness is like no one has knowledge about that thing. Clear? So these are the things scientists have cataloged, fine, but there are still many species which are left. One of the early international commissions which dealt inter alia with the question of ecology and environment was the Brandt Commission report, Brandt Commission, which had a distinguished Indian as one of its members, Mr. L.K. Jha. The first Brandt report raised the question, are we to leave our successors a scorched planet of advancing deserts, impoverished landscapes, and ailing environment? Very important concept. Now, what is Brandt Commission? Now, let me tell you that. Brandt Commission was one of the early international commissions who dealt with questions of ecology and environment. Fine. So, underline the name of the Brandt Commission only first. So, this commission was associated with creating awareness and raising questions about ecology and environment. So, I told you many organizations are there now. So, Brandt Commission is one of them. Clear? This is international commission. And L.K. Jha was one of the commission members and he was Indian. Fine. So because it is international, people from many countries were part of that. Mr. L.K. Jha was one of the Indians who was part of this organization. And the first report raised this question that are we to leave a scorched planet to our successors? Means a very poor deteriorating health, that kind of planet we are going to leave for our coming generation. Fine. So this is the question raised by this Brandt Commission. That then after that, Mr. Lester R. Brown, in his thoughtful book, The Global Economic Prospect, points out that the Earth's principal biological system, beta, this is next question now. Please underline, what is the purpose of Brandt Commission? That can be the question. Then about the species, how many species is mentioned by Nani Palkhiwala in this article, that is another question. And then Mr. Lester R. Brown, in his thoughtful book, The Global Economic Prospect, points out that the Earth's principal biological systems. Now the question is, what are the principal biological systems of the Earth? So these are fisheries, forests, grasslands, and croplands. Please underline this, all the names. Fisheries, forests, grasslands, and croplands. These are the four principal biological systems. And they are the, you can say, foundation of our global economic system. Clear? In addition to supplying our food, these four systems provide virtually all the raw materials for industry, except minerals and petroleum-derived synthetics. So most of the, you can say, input is from these four systems. Fine? Like virtually raw material is being provided. And all these four zones are, you know, base of economy. So if this will be imbalanced, this will be having the negative impact, definitely Earth will be impacted in a bad way and the consequences will be upon human beings also. So when this happens, fisheries collapse. They are telling us what is unsustainable level, what is unsustainable, you can say, consequences when any of the these departments or any of these zones will be affected. Fisheries collapse, forests disappear, grasslands are converted into barren wastelands, right? Banjar jisko bolte, no crops, no production. Croplands deteriorate. In a protein conscious, very important line, beta. Only 2 minutes left, please bear, we'll be finishing this. In a protein conscious and protein hungry world, overfishing is common every day. What does this line mean? You know, on one side, protein conscious people, you know, these days people are so much aware about their bodybuilding and going into gymming and all. They're very protein conscious. Protein hungry, and there is another category of people, those who are not getting basic protein even, means categories divided between haves and have nots. Haves means rich people, have nots means poor people. So this protein conscious and protein hungry world is actually those two worlds, like poor versus rich class. So they are saying that overfishing is common every day. How do we know need fishes? You know, many people, they eat fish for protein because this is high, very high in protein. And on the other hand, poor people, those who do not have, you know, they cannot buy products, so they just go for fishing. And this is in poor countries, local forests are being decimated in order to procure firewood for cooking. In some places, firewood means, see, you have seen that poor people, they do not have gas like the people are using cylinders and gas and such kind of things. They have, you know, firewood they use, and they will definitely cut the trees for cooking, and they will do fishing. So all these resources are used in abundance. So definitely our, and we are not, you know, doing anything, but we are using the resources too much, but you're not giving any input into it. So local forests are being decimated. They are decreasing in number because they need firewood for cooking. Firewood has become so expensive these days that what goes under the pot now costs more than what goes inside it. What does this line mean? That like cooking, you know, these days the gas is cylinder, you need to buy, it's very costly. Fine. And now even if you want to buy firewood, you know, people would cut the wood from the jungle and then they would use it. But now it is even what goes under the pot, cooking charges are higher than the dish itself, you know, understood. So the kind of thing is being cooked that is less expensive, but the materials being used like wood also, it is quite expensive. So it has become very, survival has become very difficult for the poor people. So what goes under the pot, that wood, it is costing more than what goes inside the pot. Okay, even more than vegetables, wood is costly. So tropical forest, in the words of Dr. Mears, the powerhouse of evolution. We will discuss this tomorrow because we do not have time now. So with this, I'm ending the meet. Just I hope that you all will become, awareness will be dawning upon all of us, and we will become more aware. If we cannot plant trees, but at least we will be saving our environment by taking care of our earth planet. Okay, with this, have a nice day. But we have fifth period also. Yes, today we have repeated period. I'll be continuing, and do join that. Okay, we're done. Fine.